Time. About myself, I study sports science in PhD and also as a strength conditioning coach. I have reasonable experience. However, as an athletics coach, I didn't do anything. So I'm just purely from strength conditioning coach point of view. With interaction with athletics coach, I hope I can offer something meaningful to you, but once again, I didn't do athletics as athletes. Instead, actually, I did weightlifting. Then there are a little bit similarity between two sports, athletics and weightlifting. Certain logics is quite applicable to both sports, so hopefully I can offer something meaningful to you. Why strength conditioning? To enhance the performance on top of the sports training, basically. If you do sports training only, you can get only what sports gives you. So just think about what sports needs and what doing sports itself gives you and what doing sports doesn't give you. For example, pole vault approach is only like 16 steps. What sports needs is get accelerate as much as you can take off in 16 steps. If you run only 16 steps, you never experience any speed faster than your 16 step. That's why most of the pole vault athletes run sprint more than 16 steps, like 30 meter, 60 meter. Does it make sense? Sport itself doesn't give the sense of top speed. That's why to experience the sense of top speed, athletes choose to do something never encountered in the sports training itself, such as longer sprint. Similar logic, if you just run, the resistance in the arm is only as fast as you can swing arm. Fast arm swing is required for running fast, but trying to run fast doesn't develop the strong muscular system to swing arm fast. That's why lifting weights induce adaptation more efficiently than running itself. Then, using those running training and weight training together, the training effect of the weight training will transfer to running performance. So, induced adaptation facilitates transfer by doing both strength conditioning and sports training together. Does it make sense? So it doesn't necessarily mean visibly similar, just like, all right, run with dumbbell. Doesn't necessarily mean that's the best way. Look similar doesn't necessarily mean the better transfer. Making sure something to induce the adaptation, then facilitate the transfer. Overload and specificity, that's important things. So, as I explained, you have to find what the quality the sport needs and what the modality to overload that quality to induce the adaptation. Then, how does it transfer to the sport? So, choice of the training modality and what to overload. Joints and muscle involved. So for example, this athlete, if the event is 100 meter sprint, yeah, strong arm swing is helpful. Then strong arm, how can you develop the strong arm? Joint and muscle like chest, back, A force time characteristics. Swing arm here to here, here to here. Swing backwards forwards. At the end of the range, you have to stop it and swing other way. That's required a lot of force. So something overcome the large amount of force is helpful. Then range of motion. For example, if you swing arm only in this range, is there any benefit to chin up from here to here? Yeah, actually there is a benefit because to induce the adaptation, larger range of motion create larger stress in the muscular filament. So actually to induce the adaptation, large range of motion is beneficial. Then to facilitate the transfer, when you're running training, swing arm like you run. So combination of the strength training and technical drills could create very good results. Next one. Once again.
Just to clarify.
Yes.
Your point is that we should be training larger than our range of motion, which we'll be doing for the event specific activity.
Correct. So just like separate the sports training, drills for sports technique, that's a separate things to things in strength conditioning. Sometimes strength conditioning can help athletes to learn the technique. Sometimes like sprinter do the sled toe, that's like almost gray zone between physical capacity or technique. There is space for doing that, and that actually sports of athletics doing that very well, and other sports are really learning from athletics as well. So you don't have to categorize this versus this, but there are two different aspects. Developing capacity to induce the adaptation and facilitate the transfer to utilize it in the sports are two different things. Does it make sense? Then everyone's so quiet, but if there's anything, please stop and raise a hand. Then once again, adaptation. Adaptation is specific to training. So if you train arm, your arm is getting stronger. If you train your leg gets stronger. That's like most obvious example of specific adaptation. Then by lifting heavy weights in gymnasium, physiologically speaking, what's going to happen? Intermuscular coordination, like from brain to muscle, there are better way to sending neural impulse. So by doing weight training, heavy lifting, brain learn how to coordinate neural impulse to the muscle. Next one, improved rate coding. The frequency of the neural impulse, if you train to lifting heavy, then brain send neural impulse more frequently than untrained people. So simply lifting heavy weights often, like twice a week, three times a week, actually the brain is conditioned to send the neural impulse more quickly. Next one, synchronization. So for, say, pushing ground, doing this, there are many muscles working together. If all the muscles working together, that is more efficient than one muscle working another muscle working. In addition, within the muscle, actually in one muscle, there are many motor units. Then don't need to go too much detail, but if you are familiarized and conditioned to produce large force, all the motor units can work together. If you are not familiarized, not all motor units working together, like one working now, but actually other two is not ready. So large muscle like size, there are hundreds and thousands of motor units in there. If all of those motor units working together, that's highly efficient to move fast. That is synchronization. Next one, recruitment of the type 2. Type 2 is so-called fast switch. Then, if you are suddenly told run fast, it's quite difficult to recruit all fast switch muscle. But to lifting heavy, you have to use the fast switch muscle. So if you are familiarized and conditioned to use fast switch muscle often, more likely you can utilize fast switch muscle when you need. Fast switch muscle is very expensive muscle to use it, very easy to get fatigued, and natural human protective mechanism. Human tend to reserve fast switch muscle when you need. Like suddenly lion or cheetah coming to eat you, then you are trying to escape by all means. If someone is about being eaten by cheetah or lion, yeah, probably you can utilize fast switch muscle fiber by all cost, but using fast switch muscle costs you a lot of energy, so after you use it, you get tired. If you get tired now, what would you do if lion suddenly coming? That's why human naturally reserve the fast switch muscle fiber. So if you think the athletic track is safe enough, you are not going to be chased by cheetah or tiger, better to use your fast switch muscle for your race. Then, by using the fast switch muscle fiber often, actually, fast switch muscle fiber is selectively hypertrophied. So Hawaiian-like muscle getting bigger, not the slow switch, fast switch muscle getting bigger. So actually becoming bigger doesn't mean becoming slower. That's a good benefit of lifting heavy. Then, increase the fascicle length. So, super simply speaking, doesn't change the length of bone, but the length of the muscle increase. Then, when muscle shortening, actually not all muscle is one piece. There's a block of. So, within the length of the muscle, if muscle actually getting longer means actually you have more blocks between bone to bone. If total number of the block called sarcomere, if total number of sarcomere increased and each sarcomere gets shortened in the same speed, actually the contraction velocity increase. Also, this one, disinhibition of Golgi tendon organ. Like, if you do, say, like bench press near the max, do you feel like suddenly, I'm stuck, and suddenly, like, lose the strength? Do you feel those? That's once again protective mechanism of the human. If human muscle is exposed to unsafe magnitude of tension, muscles suddenly relax to protect themselves not to be pulled. However, when you jump, when you hit gram. Super high amount of impact force there. If you inhibit muscular tension every time you hit the ground, yeah, you are not gonna hurt, but you don't run fast, you don't jump high. So if you are exposed to the high force regularly, actually your muscular system conditioned and not doing this self-protective inhibition. That's called disinhibition. Then Golgi tendon organ is, yeah, there's those organs. Golgi tendon organ is part of the tendon. It's in your tendon. So just to tell you, Golgi tendon, stay calm. Muscle working, you'll be okay. So that's the process of lifting heavy and inducing this disinhibition adaptation. Does it make sense? Then you don't have to write a physiology textbook, but athlete asking random question, if you can give them a good answer, that's quite helpful to build a rapport. If athletes don't hear fat good enough for them, it's very difficult to force them to do, especially in today's teenager. Today's teenager don't do what they don't want to do. So just to get their buy-in is quite important, and more logical, more likely to get their support. Last one, increase testosterone and growth hormone level. Generally speaking, like women's athletes think that's not for them, but there are the evidence lifting weight, using muscle, increase the testosterone and growth hormone level. Then it's not necessarily lifting weight 1 hour making you huge amount of muscle building, but having testosterone growth hormone raised for a few hours, actually, that makes athletes to feel better, feels less fatigue, and especially impactful things is like long distance endurance event. If most of the training is long hours of run, the body is becoming more catabolic, like breaking energy to create energy, breaking energy to create energy, and staying in the catabolic state forever actually feels very fatiguing. So having small dose of strength training and raising the testosterone growth hormone, those anabolic hormone levels slightly up, is actually in the long term quite helpful to avoid overtraining. That was the theory part. From here, I'm talking about more for the practical parts, what to do. Usually, let's do weight session, tell the exercise, sets and reps, and what the kilograms on the bar or intensity. If in the case of the push-up, hands on the floor, foot on the floor, or hands on the bench, foot on the floor, or most soft one, hands on the floor, knee on the floor. There are like many ways to make the adjustment in the intensity. Most of the time it's in the amount of the weight, but not limited to. Typically, I choose the exercise with large muscle mass, multiple joint, and large range of motion, like squat, deadlift, bench press, chin up. In addition, something missing from those large muscle mass, multiple joint, large range of motion exercise I add that as an assistant exercise. So stability in the rotator cuff, like shoulder. Single exercise for posture control. Local muscular endurance, like abdominal. Also, a specific reason to condition the athletes to the demands of the event, like quarter squat for impact force. Like jumping athletes has a lot of high impact force in the takeoff, and if athletes get used to those high impact force by lifting heavy in the specific range, sometimes that's helpful for their skill development. Then, especially like quarter squat, that's a really interesting exercise. Probably quarter squat is not going to induce same amount of muscular tension compared to full squat because range is so small. However, the feel of heavy weight familiarize athletes to get exposed in high force, high impact force. So actually quarter squat is more helpful in terms of like technical familiarization. Quarter squat itself wouldn't induce as much adaptation as full squat, but quarter squat can be helpful to facilitate the transfer or facilitate the learning of new skill in the track or field. Does it make sense? So each exercise has purpose. Without a purpose, exercise doesn't serve as a training. Then I make the program, usually I cover all of those four categories plus additional exercise as necessary. Sometimes I want to cover everything in one session. Sometimes as long as I can cover in 1 week or over 2 weeks, that's okay. So squatting pattern, hip hinge pattern, upper body pushing, upper body pulling, and anything else as necessary. Then, squatting. My definition of squat is ankle, knees, hips all working together. So simple exercise is like squatting. Then think about run, like this action. In my category, that's like squatting pattern. Ankle, knees, hips all together, even if ankle is merely moved. Usually like ankle should be stiff, but for this sake, actually ankle is resisting to being bent. So this I consider it as a squatting, even just like short amount. Still like pattern is squatting. There is like hip hinging. In the example exercises like Romanian deadlift. I'm on the video. Think about first step of the marker. Like this motion. Get the body forward thrown, and from head to foot, get the momentum, align the segment, and push. This bit is like hip hinge. Most of the task in athletics is combination of squatting and hip hinge. And most of the time, get the initial momentum by hip hinge and finish with squat. So ideally, I cover both of those in one session, but if athletes don't have enough time, maybe split to over two sessions. Then also like acceleration part is more like foot stays low, stay squatting pattern, but once getting top speed from here, more like foot is thrown forward and upper body pushing and upper body pulling. Some sports probably more important than other sports. Like long distance running, upper body is not as important as throwing event, but I still give it. Maybe like long distance running, one pushing and one pulling every other session is fine. Then throwing event, maybe two pushing and one pulling, one session. Next day, two pulling and one pushing. So number of the exercise, frequency can be different, specific to the individual, specific to the event. But as long as normal human being, probably better to do it more for like general reason. Especially just for good balance for the posture. If posture is very poor and keeping one sport too long, potentially bad posture inducing the different types of injury. So that's the reasoning I do all the movement pattern. Is everything making sense so far? Why everyone so quiet? Is everyone coming from like, oh, yeah, I suspect like everyone coming from East Coast, departing their time in 4 a.m., arriving here like 10 a.m. in this time means like 4 a.m. in there is like, yeah, sorry. So, try to be. Yes. Ah, yes.
With the pushing and the pulling.
Yes.
Is that overhead as well, or is it push and pull?
Can be anything.
Anything. So that's a push. That's a pull.
Yeah. So push up, shoulder press is pushing. Then chin up, bench pull is pulling. Some of exercise is very hard to categorize. Like pullover, but I still pullover is like pulling.
Thank you.
Next exercise. Next slide. So example, if I have two sessions, then like terrible example, but well, if you are in the athletics club, all come together. I don't care event. Or, like, I know you are doing different events, but for coaching logistics, if everyone can do the same thing, that's really helpful. So, just like general example. Day one, squat, single leg Romanian deadlift, bench press, lat pull, leg raise. Leg raise is exercise like laying on stomach, leg up, leg down, using the abdominal. Day two, single leg squat from sit to stand, Romanian deadlift, shoulder press, seated row, cable trunk rotation. Those are really like simple example. I pick five exercises, but in reality, it depends on facility, how many people can come in at the same time, and how much time athletes can afford. Do you think those five exercises is a realistic example to you?
Yeah, ah, yes. Obviously, I think most of us are working with like junior athletes.
Yeah.
When you're referring to like these exercises, would you like number of sets and reps for these sorts of things for like a beginner?
Mm-hmm.
I would imagine it's going to be a lot lower than like a more experienced athlete. So you've been saying that as well, and like the weight that you would use on these doesn't necessarily always have to be performed in a gymnasium setting. Do you think?
In the next slide.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah. Like often, like you are young, therefore you have to use lighter weight with more reps. That's a like typical idea, but lighter weight, more reps doesn't really specify what exactly, how many reps with how many kilograms. Then in my personal opinion, like your athlete mostly like 15 to 17 years oldish. Yeah, they are not that fragile as long as you teach it properly. Then learning new exercise, I think it's better to keep the reps somewhere around 5 to 10 reps instead of doing 20 reps, 30 reps, because frequent feedback is helpful. So do 5 reps, give a feedback, rotate, 5 reps, feedback, rotate. Or if you wanna do 10 reps, just like 5 reps, give a brief timeout, only a few seconds, then go ahead another 5, like splitting 10 reps to 5 reps and 5 reps with small rest. Like, learning new exercise, actually frequent feedback is helpful. Then, next one, hypertrophy. Once again, athletes 15 to 17, 18 years old, they're gonna get bigger without doing anything, as long as they fed properly and sleep properly. But doing the resistance exercise will facilitate healthy growth. So I don't expect doing weight training alone in that age is that much intense as trained bodybuilders. But doing high volume, like 5 to 15 reps of weight training, that will facilitate healthy growth. Then, next one, strength or power, 3 to 5 reps per set. And how many set depends on the time and depends on level of the athletes. So 2 to 5 training sets per exercise, and depends on the exercise, but usually 2 to 3 or more warm-up sets. Then fat weight, progressive overload. Then practical example, how to choose the weight. Let's say 3 sets of 10 bench press. If athlete asks what weight I should use, then how do you answer? If anyone, yes, please.
And then that's how
But the athlete doesn't know what the 3 rep max.
Maybe it couldn't have so weight, maybe it didn't take so much push-up. So for bench press, like you said there, how many push-ups can they do? If they can't do 30 push-ups, they probably just use the bar for a bit, just probably no point adding on the weight if they can't do 30 push-ups.
Oh, so before starts doing, do you need to do the push-up test?
Yeah.
Oh, that.
Because obviously, if you can't do 30 push-ups, there's any point of doing, or maybe say you can't do 20 push-ups, there's any point of doing bench press if you can't do that certain amount of push-ups.
Okay. Any other comment?
Could you not just say, we'll do 10 reps? And if you think you can do another 5, it's too light. You need to make the weight a bit heavier. So a bit of trial and error.
Ah, try and error. Good answer. Ah, yes, please.
You move up to the next level as soon as you can do 3 sets of 10.
Mm-hmm.
You can bench 50 kilograms, you can do 3 sets of 10, then you can move up to 55. After that point where you cannot do 3 sets of 10, you should not be moving up to the next level.
Yeah.
The power of the air is dangerous.
Yeah, so sorry, 3 sets of 10, 55 then?
So you have to be able to complete the weight that you're currently lifting?
Ah, yeah, I agree.
3 sets of 10 before you can move up to the next level.
Yeah, that's really good answer. Yeah, I agree. Then, this one. Yeah, I'm very impressed. Everyone is very practical people. Like if asking that in the university lecture, possibly like 60%, 70% of rep max, that's the half the answer I was preparing for, but yeah, you are very good people. So first one, just like have them to do it, and if it's easy, just to give heavier weight. If it's too hard, just to reduce the weight. Then, once again, trial and error is the best way to predict, prescribe the load. So thank you for offering such a wonderful answer. Then, if making a mistake, better to make too easy instead of too hard, more for safety reason. So usually, like new exercise, I explain to the athletes, this is what to do. Then showing demo, then have athletes to do it, few reps, ask how they feel. If you think you continue this for 10 reps, would it be a good resistance or a total waste of your time? Then if athlete says, oh, that's even 5 reps is too hard, okay, this 20 kilobar is too heavy for you, change it to 10 kilobar. If doing 20 kilo, 3-4 reps, seems like you understand the technique. All right, how do you feel? Oh, easy, all right, continue until 10 reps. After sets of 10 done, how easy was it? Then if athlete says, I could have done at least 5 more reps, means probably this athlete should be able to do 5 kilo more or 10 kilo more. Now you can use your mathematics and experience, but have them to do it in the way they can safely do and gather feedback and provide the next instruction. That's the way I would take. Then once again, something like squat, bench press, I expect few warm-up sets required. So 20 kilo feels easy, great. Then adding 5 kilo each side means 30 kilo. Do you feel that's training or feels like warm up? Okay, you feel warm up. All right, then try to 35 kilo or 40 kilo. After the 40 kilo, do you feel that's training or warm up? Then if athlete feels that's training, then start this as a set one, then 2 more set or 1 more set. If body get used to the movement, maybe athletes can lift heavier. If body gets tired, maybe athletes can do less. So just write down use this information for the next session. Like previous day, athlete did 40 kilo, 45 kilo, 45 kilo. Next session, let's go slightly more, like as he says, instead of 40, 45, 45, let's do 45, 45, then see how you feel in the last set. Something like this. A progressive overloading. Then, write down what you do is quite helpful. So, record keeping. Have athletes to write down what they do. Variation in the sets and reps. In programming, ideally, 2 to 6 weeks each of 3 sets of 10, 3 sets of 5, 3 sets of 3, then back to 3 sets of 10. If the competition is only once every 3 months, this model works perfectly. However, most of the athletics competition is not like once every 3 months. Is it? So that's why it needs to be a bit of more creativity and sense of reality. If the domestic competition is, say, like state competition is November, December, January, then national competition is February, March. During that time, maybe different. But in the off season, from June until October, no major competition, then you can do 4 weeks of 3 sets of 10, 4 weeks of 3 sets of 5, 4 weeks of 3 sets of 3, those 3 month cycle repeated. Once season started, if there's only like minor competition, if you consider that still parts of training, then you can keep doing that. Then if this is something important, athletes needs to be peaked and tapered, then needs to be slightly more shorter cycle. Say if there are 3 weeks between important competitions, then between those 3 weeks break, if you budget like 6 gym sessions, maybe 1 session of 3 sets of 10, 2 sessions of 3 sets of 5, and 2 sessions of 3 sets of 3, or something like that, you can shorten the cycle. Or if you think this athlete's probably unlikely to get any benefit by chasing any more hypertrophy or muscle mass, then just drop the 3 sets of 10 and make the rotation of 3 sets of 5 and 3 sets of 3. And those parts can be quite creative. If you want a more specific conversation, please ask me. All right, no one. Thank you. So this is an example. I just put the sets and reps in the previous example program. Sort around the programming. So within the category, exercise can be changes, back squat, front squat, leg press. Deadlift can be take over from Romanian deadlift, like more complex exercise. Shoulder press can be replaced to push press, more complex exercise. So this one, how to teach squat. General idea, toes and knees in good alignment, spine in the good neutral, and move the hip joint, change the pelvis angle, but between pelvis and spine should be no move. I show you at the gym, but usually I have athletes to sit on the box, and stand up from the box instead of ask them to how to squat. Once get used to the bottom position, it's easier to teach stand up from sitting instead of sitting from standing. A similar reason in deadlift, I usually teach lean on the wall with good posture, then bending over from leaning on the wall instead of just standing. Usually give secure platform helps athletes to